Do you think those Edomite slaves, you could abhor them or hate them?
Abhor them?
And you abhor
well,
them?
The word...
Can you detest your Edomite slaves?
Well, the word abhor means to abominable in that context. Number one, Deuteronomy 23:7, the word there for Edomite is Assyrian. It's supposed to be Syrian, not Assyrian. So, I hate an Edomite? Yes.
The word for Edomite
is a clerical error. It's a clerical error for Syrian.
What is your textual evidence for this?
Okay, you go to the Hebrew word for Edomite right there, number one, and you go back to Nahor and the Syrians and how we had brotherly dealings with them.
These days, when one looks at discussions between One West Israelites and people outside of the One West spectrum, or especially people who don't identify as Israelites at all, a subject that comes up from time to time is Deuteronomy 23:7, which many feel is at odds with the One West view of Edomites. And one common response to appeals to that verse from the One West side is to say that the current reading of Deuteronomy 23:7, which says, "Do not abhor an Edomite," in the King James Bible, that the current reading contains a quote-unquote clerical error. In this video, I'd like to briefly cover some of the history of that response, explain what it posits, and also share my thoughts on why I think it's somewhat misguided. To begin, I'm going to show a clip of GMS. Now, this footage is more than a decade old, and it's my understanding that GMS was the first group to take this position, and it has spread outward from them to other One Westers. Now, it's important to note that in this clip, Ariam Lob attributes the idea to someone who is apparently not a One Wester. So this slightly more than 10-year-old footage captures when the idea first entered into the One West spectrum. Also, it's interesting to note that when you watch this 10-year-old footage, you can see them making the transition in real time from a previous response, which was to say, oh, the verse only meant not to look down on Esau because of, his skin color or something like that, to this new response, which is to say that it's a clerical error. So we're going to take a look at this early GMS use of this approach, which has pretty much remained the same as it spread to other One Westers, and then we'll explore what it means and why I think it's misguided.
You go on one level, then go deep on one level. Just give them the first level, then go to the
deep level. The first level that, see that, because they're trying to use that Deuteronomy 23:7. Now, the Deuteronomy, can somebody get that Deuteronomy 23:7? All right, read it, brother.
You got it? All right. Brother got it.
Seven, right.
All right. Thou shalt not abhor an Edomite.
Right. It said, thou shalt not abhor an Edomite. Now, when you read the scripture, they'll make it seem like it's saying, don't hate an Edomite. Right. Don't hate the white man. Right. The word abhor does not mean hate. The word abhor means to, like, avoid, to hold in disdain, to look down on. That's what that scripture means. Right? Read on.
All right. For he is thy brother.
For he is thy brother. So they see that and say you shall not abhor Edomite, meaning that you're not supposed to hate Esau. But that's not what that scripture means, right?
Right.
On the one level, right, it means, if it's talking to Edomites, right, that was really referring to you're not supposed to look down on Esau because he looked different, right? But when you go into the Strong's Concordance, because there was this guy named Pastor Emashir, right? And what he did was, he brought it a good point. I don't know if he's a Jake, I don't know if he's an Edomite, but he brought it a good point. Do you know what he found out? He found out that scripture and that particular verse there, when you go to the Strong's Concordance and you look up the word Edomite in that particular scripture, the word, the number for the Strong's Concordance number is number 130. When you look up the number 130, right, it says a cleric, it says Esau, you know, it says Edom, whatever. It says, and then it's, and as you read on down, it says a clerical error for 726. Right? Now, when you read 726 in the Strong's Concordance, you know what the word there is? Aram. And Aramaean. So really, the word that should be there should be thou shalt not abhor an Aramaean. Exactly. It's a different nation. It's not the Edomite. Now, in some, like we said, some parts of the Strong's Concordance, they go off. Some parts, they're on point. In that particular part, they're on point. Because really, it's supposed to be an Aramaean.
I personally am not a big fan of making recourse to Strong's Concordance, but nonetheless, since that's what Arayam Lob was appealing to, and since that's what everyone who takes this approach appeals to, let's take a look at Strong's Concordance. On your screen is the actual entry for number 130, Hebrew entry, Hebrew word number 130, H130, in Strong's Concordance. Now, recall that Arayam Lob said that that text states that it's a clerical error for number 726.
When you look up the number 130, right, it says a clerical error for 726.
Arayam Lob was mistaken. That's not what the text states. What it actually states at the end of the entry is simply C726. At the entry for Hebrew 130, there is no reference to number 130 being a clerical error for number 726. That said, let's take a look at Hebrew entry number 726, or number H726. So here it is here, and what you'll notice is that it states that number 726 is a quote-unquote clerical error for H130. In other words, it states the exact opposite of what Arayam Lob said. He had the order backwards. It's not that 130 is a clerical error for 726. Rather, 726 is a clerical error for 130. But there's more. There's something that Arayam Lob didn't point out, and it's something that is also not noted by seemingly any One Wester that I've seen make this claim, at least in my experience. And that's that at number 726, it states in parentheses, as in the margin. Note that phrase, as in the margin, which I'll zoom in here. And ask yourself this question, what does that mean? What margin is being referred to? This question is a significant one, and the answer is important to understanding what's going on here. So what margin is being referred to? This is a bit more clear in the corresponding entry in Jesenius, where it's stated that this is an incorrect reading for Adomi, and which stands in Kri, or Kre, however you want to pronounce that. Today in modern times, people say Kri, and I've seen older texts go with Kre. But whatever the case, relate just as the entry in Strong's Concordance says, as in the margin, this entry in Jesenius refers to Kre, or Kri. And that begs the question, what is that referring to? What is that Kuf Resh Yod referring to? What's being referred to pertains to the concepts of Ketib and Kre. This pertains to the Masoretic text from which the Old Testament of most Bibles are translated. And Ketib refers to the main text, what's written in the main text of the Masoretic text. However, when you're looking at a printed edition of the Masoretic text, in the margins, there's a marginal note, which often there's a marginal note on different factors, and there will be a marginal note on how the text should be read. In other words, there's certain places where the Masoretes received a written form which they felt was mistaken, but they didn't want to correct what they received. So they, rather than change what they received, they put the correction in terms of how it should be read in the marginal note. Ketib refers to what is written, and Kre refers to what is recited, what is read aloud. If you take a look at a printed edition of the Tanakh, you'll see lots of those marginal notes. But in this case, I'm looking at the 16th chapter of 2 Kings. And here you see the word Aramim, right? Aramim, Arameans. And you'll see in the marginal note, it says Adomim, Edomites. So this is the Kre, this is the marginal note that's correcting what's written. Moreover, we find secondary support for this in the Septuagint, where in the same verse where Arameans appears in the Masoretic text, we find Edomites appearing in the Septuagint. So whatever Hebrew text the Septuagint was translating read Adomim, Edomites. So to quickly recap, in the Masoretic version of 2 Kings 16:6, specifically 2 Kings 16:6, the main text, the Ketib, refers to Arameans. Aramim, and while the marginal note, the Kre, states instead that it should be read as referring to Edomites. Moreover, the Septuagint provides independent support for the Masoretic marginal note, as it too has a reference to Edomites, not Arameans, at 2 Kings 16:6. So this is what Strong's Concordance and Jesenius' lexicon is referring to when it states that H726, a specific rendering for Arameans, is a quote-unquote clerical error or incorrect reading for H130 Edomites. In other words, Edomites is the correct reading for 2 Kings 16:6 based on the marginal note on the Kri in the Masoretic text. Now, you won't find a corresponding situation with the Masoretic reading of Deuteronomy, which is where we're at, specifically the 23rd chapter. And when you go to the what corresponds to the 7th verse in the King James Bible, you'll find the word Adomi, Edomite, and there isn't any correction in the margin. There's just a reference to Rabi'iv, which means the 4th section of this particular portion, but no Kri correction.
Come on.
So, too, when you turn to the Septuagint version of Deuteronomy 23, what you find is the word Idumeon, Edomites. So, in the Septuagint, the whatever ancient Hebrew text the Septuagint was translating read Edomites, Edomite in the singular, in Deuteronomy 23:7. So, in conclusion, Ariamlab, as well as subsequent One Westerners who followed his lead, have it backwards. Strong's Concordance was referring to specifically Arameans in specifically 2 Kings 16:6 being incorrect as per the marginal note in the Masoretic text. This does not in any way give any license to people to just arbitrarily declare Edomites in, or it's Edomite in the singular, in Deuteronomy 23:7 to be wrong. In order to correct a reading, in order to change a reading, you have to have some sort of manuscript support. In the case of 2 Kings 16:6, we have the marginal note in the Masoretic text, and we have the reading in the Septuagint. There is no such support in favor of changing the text in Deuteronomy 23:7. Therefore, the One Westerners who take this approach and claim that Deuteronomy 23:7 contains a clerical error are simply flipping the logic of Strong's Concordance on its head, and they're putting it in reverse. They have it backwards. They have it wrong, essentially. You know, and they need to understand that their position does not have the support that one finds for what Strong's was actually referring to. Now, in my experience, when this has been explained to One Westerners who tried to assert that the clerical error appears at Deuteronomy 23:7, they attempt to respond to that by asserting that they can correct the reading based on what makes sense to them personally. But I have to say now, anticipating others making that sort of objection, I have to say now that I'm sorry, it doesn't work that way. If you're going to propose a different reading for a given biblical verse, you have to present some sort of textual support, whether it be a marginal note from the Masoretic text or an alternative reading in one of these ancient translations like the Septuagint or the Vulgate or the Peshitta, you know, something like that, or some sort of manuscript evidence. But in the absence of any of that support, you have no justification for asserting that a clerical error appears in Deuteronomy 23:7.
Do you have one example of where that's translated as in Assyrian?
Yes.
Okay. Now, if that's the case, is an Assyrian your brother?
Yes.
Okay, so Assyrians are your brother. Will you put them in slavery?
Yes.
So you can enslave your brother?
Yes, them, because you can't enslave another Israelite, though, the same way that you can't enslave...
Non-Israelites are your brother.
That's why you got to look at the context, okay? Leviticus speaks about ruling over them with rigor. You can rule over another nation with rigor, despite the fact that you're their brother.
Okay.
In that context.
So you can rule over your brother, the Assyrian, because you're saying that's what Deuteronomy 23:7 really means. And the, you're saying that you can rule over them.
In that context, they're called brother, yes.
And so you can't hate Assyrians?
No, the word abhor means to do abominable. I can't do anything like, okay.
So you think it's abominable to put someone in slavery?
No.
Okay, so
this is according with the laws of God. I can't have sex with their wife.
If it's not abominable to be in slavery, then what was so bad about slavery?
Our slavery?
About anyone's slavery.
No, it's not anything. Anyone's slavery isn't, that's none of my concern. The problem with us is, matter of fact, let me just give the scripture.
So like the Assyrians, some of them were enslaved by the Ottoman Turks.
Mm-hmm. Let me just read
was that abominable for the Assyrians to be slaved by the Ottoman Turks?
I'm not concerned with the Assyrians.